Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're steelhead fishing on the Sandy River in Oregon, plus a little Chinook salmon on the Columbia. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. This morning, we're on the lower section of the Sandy River near Portland, Oregon with Don Newman, Dave Eng, and Jason Hambly of Pro Cure, and we're in search of winter steelhead.
We ran upriver to the deadline, which is right at the top end of Dabney Park, and we're going to start here and fish this and then work our way down and do some bobber and jig fishing today and some bobber doggin. The top end of Dabney Park, they set in place a deadline for power boats, which you can't fish above. It gives the guys that are coming down in drift boats a little extra water to fish where they're not interrupted by us guys in power boats. So, yep, go ahead.
You want me further than that, or Jay?
As far as you can.
Okay.
The nice thing about bobber dogging, if you're running the boat, you can really kind of control your drift on what everybody's doing and keeping everything going down at an even rate. The bobbers are designed with a flat bottom on them, so they kind of plow the current, and you can leave a little belly in your line, and what it does is it drags this tangle-free weight down along the bottom, and while it's doing that, it keeps your line coming down, your rig's coming down at a perfect angle, and even with the current. And on these, I'm just running a double bead setup here. It's got more of a floating bead on the top, and then in the back I just got a more of a neutrally buoyant bead. I just wanted to make a quick pass upriver with a bobber dog rig real quick and see what happens, and with the water clearing up and all that, we're going to go down and fish a couple of the deeper holes and run jigs through them and see what happens.
So what we're using today to float fish, we've got 30-pound P-line X-braid, and we've got a float, an inline weight. I've got about a 24-inch section of fluorocarbon leader. We're using the P-Line CFX fluorocarbon leader. And then we've got the new Spro RkStar jigs. Kind of a cool head. They're going to sit real nice in the water. And the one nice thing about this jig is it's got a really good hook on it.
So I'm using the pink and white RkStar jig here from Spro, and I'm going to tip it with a shrimp tail, and I'm going to use a bait button behind that. Let me show you how that works here real quick. Simply slide that on, and to keep that bait up there on the front end, you simply just put this bait button right through the hook and just pull it through there, and that little washer, so to speak, just pushes right up against the back of the shrimp and keeps it nice and tight up there so it doesn't fall off.
All right, go ahead and get ready, guys. We're going to fish this little trench over here, this soft inside seam. Wait a minute, because it drops off just down here a little bit further. All right, go ahead and cast downriver now, right over on the edge. Pull it in a little bit.
So definitely when we're fishing the jigs, it's a lot more technical than the bobber dogging. We're wanting to achieve that drag-free drift, which means we're trying to keep the line mended at all times, so to not have any interference with the drift on the float and the jig.
So what you want to try to do when you're bobber and jig fishing is matching your amount of your weight combined with your, on a slip float, combined with your inline sinker to your lead head. So I'm running a 1/2 ounce float here. So what I'm running is 1/4 ounce inline weight and 1/4 ounce jig head. And that evens it out perfectly, because you want that water line right to be at the end of your color here, just so there's very little resistance when the fish goes to grab it, and just buries your bobber as quickly as possible. So.
Fish.
Oh, there you go. grab that net there, Don.
That fish was sitting in real shallow water. It was probably a foot and a half deep there, but
there's a little bucket in there they're always in. So, and I guess it was in here again.
Good job, Dave. That's a cute little one you got.
We found one. Hatchery?
Looks like it.
Yep.
This is one of the Beckman catch and release nets. You know, the nice thing is it's got a flat bottom in it. The hooks don't get caught up in the netting material. But this is a hatchery fish, so we don't have to worry about catch and release on this one.
You know what I like about that net, Don? Is the fact that it's got the extension handle, so that when you really want to reach out there and, you know, when you're fishing long leaders, that thing extends way out.
Yeah, one thing nice about this is a 4-foot handle, but like Dave was saying, it's got the extension, so we can go from a 4-foot handle to a 6-foot handle pretty quickly, or 7-foot handle, excuse me. So this is what we call a 4x3, 4-foot handle with a 3-foot extension, making it a 7-foot handle. Also on the net is a product called an Ultra Float. It's a Canadian product, and basically what it is, it's just two floats that go right on the handle. I think every one of us who's ever spent any time on the water has lost the net, had it bounce over the side. And these floats will float it up. So if it does happen to bounce out of the boat or slip out of your hands, you're gonna be able to just swing the boat around and pull it out of the water. So good product, it'll save you a $100 net.
Welcome back to the Sandy River. I'm Justin Wolf. Dave Eng has our first fish of the day on a Spro RkStar jig.
So we caught this guy on a pink and white RkStar jig, tipped with a little bit of shrimp, and found him over here in a little 3-foot bucket that's about 2 feet long.
It's a marabou jig, so you don't want to put a bunch of gels or oils on it because it'll mat down those feathers. So the best thing to use is the water soluble. This is the krill, works out. This is always a pretty effective sand. Douse it in that, and ready to go. The rod we're running is the Cousins Evo series. We got the Evo 105M. It's a 10.5 foot rod. And basically you want that extra length to kind of give you some more mendability and help you get a better presentation on your jig when you're flow fishing. It's a pretty important part of it, so.
Yeah, you said they like that shallow water over there?
Yeah. Some water that, like I pointed out to Don a little bit ago, it doesn't always look like the fishiest water. It's real shallow, but for some reason the fish will hold there. So.
Coming through. Yeah, he rolled in the line. All right. So what we've got here is just a little wild buck. That one actually, we're using that double rig. So the top of the rig had eggs in the yarn ball, the bottom had a bead on. It actually bit the middle bait, which was the eggs. And got him in that catch and release net. You know, he was holding real nice, but we're gonna just dump him out and let him go.
So the egg here we were running on these eggs, we ended up using the new fuse egg cure, and I ended up just putting them in. I kind of rushed them on the cure time, and I ended up putting them in some borax too to dry them out as well. But as you can see, they work.
It's been a really unusual winter up here on the Sandy. There hasn't been a lot of rain. As you can see, the water is just crystal clear. So we're using fluorocarbon. Two different P-line products that we're using. One is the CFX fluorocarbon. You'll notice that
there we
this,
go.
Is, this is a, oh.
You'll notice Jay's using the CFX fluorocarbon there.
That was that same little bucket that Dave got the fish in earlier, wasn't it?
It was.
Came back, let it rest a little bit.
Yeah. This one's what we're after.
Just switch up that jig, Jay?
Yeah, I put on the Spro Nightmare.
Oh, you switch from that pink and white to the
black
to the
red.
Nightmare, black and red.
Is that straight through?
This one's a little bigger than we've been getting. This one feels like it's maybe 10 pounds or so. Nice, big, healthy native.
Net.
Nice,
yeah. Wild fish going back in the drink. The nightmare, well, what's commonly called a nightmare, is the black, red, and white. And this color combination, it seems like the clearer the water gets, the more productive it becomes. And even in off-color water with that black marabou in there, it really poses a nice contrast. And it's just probably the best all-purpose jig there is.
Like we were trying to explain before Jason interrupted us with that big native hen, Sandy's real clear, so we're using fluorocarbon. We've got two different fluorocarbons from P-Line that are rigged on both rods today. One is the CFX fluorocarbon, super tough, durable, awesome abrasion resistance. You'll notice it comes in a new package. We've upgraded the package, just updated the look a little bit. The second one is a product that the guides are really liking, and that's the SS fluorocarbon. The reason they're liking it, comes in 100-yard spools. It's also real soft, easy to tie, doesn't retain a lot of memory when you put it on one of the fishing boards or a leader wheel or something like that. So this is one that we've really been doing well with. 100% fluorocarbon, gonna give you just that little bit of advantage when the water's low and clear.
For today's fishing, we recommend the Cousins Tributary Series GTS 105MTG, the Daiwa Ballistic 2500 size spinning reel, P-Line Salmon and Steelhead fluorocarbon leader, Maruto Barbless Grabber Hooks, Procure water-soluble krill and krill bait wax, and ProDogger and ProDrift floats from Fishfield.
Hey, I hope you're enjoying today's episode. Now, before we go do some more fishing on the Columbia River, I want to take a minute to explain about the different bobbers that were used today on the Sandy River. Using two types of bobbers, the traditional drift float, this is a Fishfield Pro Drift float, and the bobber doggin float, a relatively new advancement in bobber fishing. Now, these floats have two different shapes and two different functions for fishing. Now, the drift float, or this Pro Drift float, they come in sizes from 1/8 all the way to 5 ounces. So as it's floating down along with the current, the key for you is to match the amount of weight you have hanging under your float with the bobber. So this is a 2 ounce float, so theoretically it's going to take 2 ounces to pull that float down, so the water line's right here, right where it just almost wants to go under. So when a fish grabs it, even very lightly, it's going to pull that bobber under, because you don't want the fish to feel your float. Now, the bobber doggin float, or this Pro Drift float by Fishfield, it's a chop bobber. Originally, people used to just take a regular bobber and chop it off, so it's called a chop bobber. But it's a bobber doggin bobber. And the idea is that it's going to float down the river and actually be pushed down the river with the water pushing up against the flat side of the face here. So the larger the diameter of the bobber, the more force against it with the water pushing against it. So in slower water, you're going to use a bigger bobber, and in faster water, a slower bobber. Now, these come in three different sizes, M, L, and LL, or small, medium, and large. If you're just gonna try one, just wanna try it, go with the L. That's the best seller, and will match up with a majority of the water in the Northwest. Now we're gonna head up the Columbia River to do some salmon fishing with Josh Cooper and the new Max Lure Sledgehammer. This is a lure that Josh actually helped design. He's been working on it for a few years, and it's very effective with his Hot Wings blade. Now, he calls it a tack hammer in the show because back then that's what it was called when we filmed this. But now this is the new sledgehammer, really hot new lure from Max Lure. Now let's go to the Columbia River and catch some salmon.
We've launched just below Bonneville Dam on the lower Columbia River. We're with Josh Cooper of Cousins Tackle, hoping to hook up with Chinook salmon. Josh has had good luck with a new lure design. We'll see how it goes today.
So what we're going to run here today is actually a lure that we've been developing for a couple of years through Max. We're calling it the Tack Hammer. Basically, it's one of their hot wing blades with a hoochie skirt some crystal flash and big salmon size treble hooks.
So we're going to run these behind a rotating flasher, 18 to 24 inch leaders. Because of this design, no drag compared to a normal spinner blade, there's basically no drag. So what you'll get is this tack hammer lure darts around a lot more than a traditional spinner with a metal blade, and you get a lot more action out of your lure. You'll actually notice that your flasher turns in a bigger circle also because of that lack of drag. We've done really, really well with these for the last couple of years. No one really knew about them, but they'll be available on the market here real soon.
Hey Josh, how deep do you want to run?
We're going to run start out. The bow rods will run them at 30. The side rods back here and back here will run at 35 to start out.
Okay.
Straight out or in?
Straight out. It's all 65 feet here, and it's going to shallow up. We're going to come up onto the shelf, and it's a big flat. So that's why we're starting at 35, because it's going to come up real fast. And we'll troll right up on top of that, and we should be just a couple feet off the bottom within about 50 yards here. What we have here is you can see our flasher and our weight. So the flasher is obviously the rotating part there, and then down below it is we're picking up our weight. And not a lot of fish around there right now, but when we get into them down here and the bottom comes up, we should start marking a whole bunch of fish. It shouldn't be too much longer. Real, real fast. You got to pull hard, remember. Keep going. Can you clear this one for me? Pull up on that. Keep that rod bent, baby. You're going to grab that net, Jay. Keep that rod bent, baby girl. So just so you know, she does have a life jacket on. It's underneath her jacket here. Oh, it's gone. Oh.
Next
your hands hurt? Well, you'll get the next one, baby.
My hands are bad.
That'll happen. So that one just came unbuttoned. We'll get the next one. So we're going to get this one ready to put out again. These have really, really lightweight Mylar blade here. Available from Mack. Actually, the blade itself isn't, but these lures will be available from Mack. Nice thing is with the Hoochie body, you can put your favorite scent, your favorite Procure scent. Procure Bloody Tuna is what we're typically running out here. And you can just scent them up all you want, ready to go. Good stout wire hooks, don't straighten out. And that's how we're gonna run it.
Welcome back. So we're on the Columbia River just below Bonneville Dam doing a little salmon fishing with the new Mack Lure Sledgehammer. Now Mack actually has several other salmon products that maybe you've never heard of, but they're really interesting. You might want to take a look. This is the Cha-Cha Squidder with the big smile blade. Lots of flash, lots of action. A really effective lure, especially in the salt water. Then also, the same kind of idea, a big bulky bait, the large wiggle hoochie with this crankbait-like bill. Puts out a lot of vibration in the water. The fishes tear it up, especially out in the ocean. I've seen some incredible days of fishing with this lure. And then also the Mack Lure Scorpion Spinner, a big two-bladed spinner, originally designed for the California market, but it's been effective in lots of places. So if you're looking for a big spinner, here you go. Now let's head back to the Columbia River on a day where there's very few fish in the system and see if we can't get this sledgehammer to work for us on a slow day on the Columbia.
We're running 16 ounces of lead here, so we kind of want to have a pretty good control over our depth, even if we're varying our speed a little bit. So those heavier leads will let you control your depth without it blowing back there, so we're not too concerned about getting it way far away from the boat. It's a big boat, so we're able to get the bow rods way up there. We don't really have tangle problems for the most part. And so basically what we're able to do is run 16s. I run 16s on all these rods. If I were running herring, I'd be running 12s out the back and get them back away from the boat. But with these, I like to have more control on my depth. So I'll just run the big heavier leads everywhere. So we've hooked a couple fish, but they've come unbuttoned. It's not real hot. There's plenty of boats around and no one's really absolutely killing them. So we're gonna go ahead and run up to the deadline at the dam, and we'll go ahead and do a kind of change it around, do an upstream troll. with the same setup, and basically just creep really slow up the river and see if we can get them at the deadline.
There's one. Oh, he's screaming.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
All right. Holy cow. Jeez.
He's out there. Look at that.
200 feet of line. Oh.
Dang it.
No, he's, look at him ripping around out there. He's going crazy. I don't know. He's acting like it. There we go. Hey, Jay, you want to grab that motor? Dude, he ripped us up. He ran 195 feet on the line counter, which doesn't happen very much. So that's kind of cool. Yeah, he just took off and lit me up. So he ran out there on the surface and was shooting all around. It's kind of neat. Oop, he's back here, Jay. Watch that rod holder there. It's a big fish. Ready? We'll go one more time. There we go. That's a dandy.
Boy, he lit us up. That's a good one.
Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.